1541. The New World. The Spanish conquistador Hernando de Soto became the first European to lay eyes on the Mississippi. For him, it was nothing but a barrier to his search for gold. But later, explorers would discover the river held its own treasures, waters teeming in wildlife. Another 140 years passed before Europeans finally reached the river's mouth. It was here that La Salle claimed this whole territory for France. The French were drawn to this maze of swamps and bayous by the river's wild treasures, in particular by infinite numbers of beavers, whose pelts could be obtained by trading with local Indians. But friendly relations didn't last. And soon the Mississippi began to take on its modern, more familiar character. So far, our journey has taken us north from the Delta swamps, through New Orleans, as far as the city of St. Louis. But the journey is far from over. St. Louis is dominated by a 192-meter-high arch, a symbolic gateway to the west. But the city itself is a real gateway. St. Louis played a key role in opening the west to American settlement. That's because the city straddles two major rivers, which means from here, the journey divides. One heads west along the Missouri, and the other north towards the distant source of the Old Man River itself. Yet St. Louis wasn't the first major city to grow up alongside these two mighty rivers. Another great civilization flourished here, called the Mississippian, a civilization that had flowered and died centuries before Columbus stepped onto the shores of the New World. Around three centuries ago, when the first Europeans explored here, they found vast forests and swamps. And the descendants of that great civilization, tribes like the Illinois, these people lived in large villages around which they farmed the rich soils of the Mississippi floodplain. The Mississippi was America's Nile. Its floods fertilized the Indians' fields and gave them a good life. But although they depended on their crops of corn, beans, and squash, they also hunted in the forests alongside the riverbank. For Indians, those natural resources had both practical and spiritual significance. They had a pact with the creatures they hunted, and so long as the hunter showed respect for the hunted, then the animals of the forest and river would continue to give themselves up to sustain Indian life. Hunting was the job of the men, and to be successful, they had to have an intimate understanding of the creatures of the forest. One creature that these Indians would have been familiar with is the red wolf. Unlike its more familiar cousin, the gray wolf, red wolves don't hunt in large packs. They live in pairs, and both parents cooperate to raise their lively pack of youngsters. But today this is a rare sight. Red wolves once ranged over much of the eastern United States, but they were persecuted by European settlers who didn't share the same pact with nature that the Indians did. By the early 1970s, they were on the brink of extinction, and the last few wild ones were caught and taken to breeding centers. In 1980, the red wolf was declared extinct in the wild. Luckily, the captive population thrived. There are now 150 wolves in captivity, and they've produced enough young to begin reintroducing them to the wild. Some of these new populations did well, and now there are about 100 red wolves living wild again, in remote areas of North Carolina. It remains to be seen whether these intimate scenes of family life will ever become a part of the Mississippi forests again. North of St. Louis, the river separates into many strands or opens out into lakes, a confusing maze of water and vegetation for the first explorers. The first expedition to navigate this verdant labyrinth was led by Louis Joliet, a French explorer, and Father Jacques Marquette, a Jesuit priest. In 1673, they traveled down from New France, that vast area claimed by France across the north of the continent. From the Great Lakes, they carried their canoes to the Wisconsin River and paddled downstream until they entered the Mississippi. From here, they paddled on into unknown territory. At first, they didn't find much evidence of human habitation, just occasional footprints in the soft river sand and abandoned dugout canoes. But as they explored the banks, they found areas where the forest gave way to open grass, places inhabited by some very strange creatures.
We call them wild cattle because they're very similar to our domestic cattle. They are not longer, but are nearly as large again and more corpulent.
Because the French called them cattle, bœuf, they later became known as buffalo. In Marquette and Joliet's day, these icons of the Great Plains were also found as far as Pennsylvania and New York, living in forests as well as on open grasslands. Leaving the buffalo, the two explorers pushed on.
We silently followed the narrow path, and after walking about 2 leagues, we discovered a village on the bank of a river.
Bonjour!
As we were only 2 men and had given them notice of our arrival, they deputed 4 old men to come and speak to us. We therefore decided that it was time to reveal ourselves. This we did by shouting with all our energy and stopped without advancing any farther. 2 of these bore tobacco pipes, finely ornamented and adorned with various feathers. They walked slowly and raised their pipes towards the sun, seemingly offering them to it to smoke. Without, however, saying a word. I therefore spoke to them first and asked them who they were. They replied that they were Illinois.
The Illinois were very hospitable, as most Indian tribes were on first contact, and invited them into a hut, though these strangely dressed men were objects of polite curiosity.
After we'd taken our places, the usual civility of the country was paid to us, which consisted of offering us the calumet. This must not be refused, unless one wishes to be considered an enemy, or at least uncivil.
The Frenchmen were received as honored guests, and the Illinois gave them the benefit of their intimate knowledge of the great river and what lay ahead for the explorers. As the little expedition picked its way downstream, they saw the abundance of the river for themselves. Life was everywhere. Sandy banks and islands are perfect places for turtles, like this spiny soft shell, to emerge from the river, to dig a nest and bury their eggs. But the best sites on this bank have already been taken. Once finished, the turtle carefully backfills the hole to hide her eggs from predators. The soft shell has little choice but to head back to the river and find another sandbank. Having a softer and lighter shell than the other turtles on the river, it can move faster and travel further. Soft shells have been known to travel over 30 kilometers in search of suitable sandbanks to lay their eggs. Marquette and Joliet had hoped the river might lead them west, an easy passage to the Pacific Ocean, but instead, it carried them even further south, until they reached a place where another mighty river emptied into the Mississippi. They realized that this new river, later called the Missouri, might well be a passage west, but they didn't explore it. It would indeed prove to be the elusive route west, which is why, nearly 300 years after Marquette and Joliet passed by, this great arch was built. The Jefferson National Expansion Memorial, a symbolic gateway to the West. The arch is in St. Louis, the great metropolis that grew up just a few miles south of the confluence of these two great rivers. But at the beginning of the 19th century, St. Louis was a small frontier settlement. And just north of the little town where the Missouri and Mississippi joined, a major expedition to explore the Missouri was being assembled. The leaders of the expedition were Captain Meriwether Lewis and William Clark, and the expedition had been the brainchild of the U.S. President Thomas Jefferson. Jefferson had just bought a vast territory from France, an area they called Louisiana. Much larger than the present state of Louisiana, it more than doubled the size of the young United States. but only a tiny fraction of this Louisiana Purchase had been explored, and the U.S. wanted to know exactly what they had bought. Jefferson asked Lewis and Clark to explore the whole length of the Missouri, and then to cross to one of the Pacific rivers to find the best way to the west. An expedition that demanded a lot of thought and careful preparation. Lewis sent for a keelboat to carry their rapidly growing stores and supplies. The slow and difficult journey down the Ohio River and Mississippi to the expedition's base camp. The lockers on the boat could also be lifted to provide protection if needed. Lewis and Clark knew that they might need to defend themselves at times. French fur trappers provided a little information on what they might expect along their route, but there was also much to be discovered, from Indian cultures to geology and wildlife. Their route would take them along the Missouri and then across to the Rockies, to the Columbia River, which would finally take them to the shores of the Pacific. On their way, they would encounter spectacular scenery. By May of 1804, preparations were complete and the expedition was ready to leave. And the Corps of Discovery began their arduous journey by battling upstream against the powerful Missouri Current. Their journey led north and west and took them into completely new landscape. The forests along the Missouri gradually diminished until they gave way to vast open prairies, a sea of grass. The explorers were impressed with what they saw. In early September, they came across a most curious creature.
His nostrils large, his eyes like a sheep. He is more like the antelope or gazelle of Africa.
These were the first descriptions of the pronghorn antelope. Unsure what they had found, Lewis and Clark subsequently called this creature a goat. But in truth, it is neither goat nor antelope, but the only member of an extinct family. Beneath the feet of the pronghorn, the great plains were alive with other life. Prairie dogs and burrowing owls. These curious owls live in burrows often stolen from the prairie dogs, which they defend with far more aggression than their size should permit. The reason for all that aggression is the owl's chicks, exploring the above-ground world of the plains for the first time. And it's as well to be vigilant. Prairie dog towns are always patrolled by coyotes. Ignoring the owl's protests, the coyote's trick is to appear as nonchalant as possible, hoping to catch a prairie dog off guard and too far from the safety of its hole. As night falls, a new prairie world appears, most of which the Corps of Discovery didn't even know existed. The night air is filled with the songs of crickets and katydids. But down here, where the sea of grass is more like a jungle, these nighttime songsters need to be careful. Their songs are easily heard by the prairie's most unusual predator, a carnivorous mouse. The grasshopper mouse is a hunter. Scurrying through the tangle of grass stems, it pounces on any insect that is too slow to escape and devours it alive. Even the long legs and rapid jumps of katydids are not enough to escape this voracious rodent. And it can crunch its way through its own body weight in grasshoppers each night. Oblivious to this hidden prairie world, the Corps of Discovery pressed on. As they explored through present-day Nebraska, they found huge colonies of prairie dogs, of which they made meticulous descriptions.
The little animal found in the plains of the Missouri, which I have called the barking squirrel, weighs from 3 to 3.5 pounds. Its form is that of the squirrel.
Lewis's name was apt, as these little rodents give sharp, high barks to warn their neighbors of danger. Some of the colonies, called prairie dog towns, were truly enormous, extending for tens of kilometers and containing millions of animals. In Lewis and Clark's day, the sea of grass was also a sea of life. Prairie dog burrows made homes for more than just prairie dogs. Despite its warning rattle, a rattlesnake is in great danger of being trampled when a herd of buffalo passes by. But in a dog town, there's always a handy bolt hole. Jefferson had given the Corps of Discovery another mission. Apart from finding the easiest way to the Pacific, they were also to make collections of the flora and fauna along their route. Much of it being seen for the very first time. They decided that Jefferson would appreciate a live prairie dog, but getting hold of one of these wary creatures wasn't going to prove that easy. At the first sign of danger, they disappear into burrows that run deep beneath the prairie.
We attempted to dig to the beds of one of those animals. After digging 6 feet, found, by running a pole down, that we were not halfway to his lodge.
Since digging them out clearly wasn't going to work, Lewis and Clark's men then tried to flush one out by pouring water into its hole, which eventually worked. This prairie dog lived out its days in the White House with President Jefferson. After triumphing over a prairie dog, the expedition moved on, often through stormy weather as the Missouri led them ever westwards. At times, the rolling plains gave way to eroded badlands. The Corps of Discovery only glimpsed this extraordinary landscape, but later explorers who came here described it as hell with the fires put out. Yet to the Indians living here, these were sacred landscapes. As the expedition explored the high plains of South Dakota, they came across ever-increasing numbers of buffalo.
From an eminence, I had a view of the plains for a great distance. I had a view of a greater number of buffalo than I'd ever seen before at one time. I must have seen near 20,000.
The numbers of buffalo in Lewis and Clark's day was truly amazing. Possibly up to 70 million of them. Great herds migrated over the plains in search of grazing, often blackening the landscape with their numbers. While Lewis and Clark were exploring the West, another expedition set out to try and find the still unknown source of the Mississippi. The man entrusted with this was Zebulon Pike. Like Lewis and Clark, he'd started with a keelboat, but the upper Mississippi proved too difficult to navigate. Eventually, he had to travel on foot, tracking the winding river through Minnesota's northern forests. Pike left late in the year, so as he was heading north, birds were already heading south, using the Mississippi to guide their route, away from the northern winter. But there was still plenty of wildlife around, as Pike recorded in his diary.
October 10th, Thursday. Passed a cluster of islands, more than 20 in the course of 4 miles. These I called beaver islands, from the immense sign of those animals, for they have dams on every island and roads from them every 2 or 3 rods.
As Pike pressed on north, the beavers were beginning to prepare for winter. Their thick, luxuriant fur that tempted the French fur traders here insulates the beaver from cold water, while they trim up leafy branches ready to store underwater. These submerged branches will be their winter larder, still accessible from their lodge when the lakes and ponds freeze over. This is also the time to carry out repair work on their lodge, their sanctuary from the freezing winter ahead. The entrance is underwater so it won't freeze up, and inside remains warm. Occasionally, beavers have a litter of kits as late as November, but with a supply of fresh food outside the front door and a cozy den, even these late litters have a good chance of surviving. The prelude to winter in these northern forests is truly spectacular. As the trees turn to red and gold, a harvest of nuts provides a last feast before the bitter winter sets in. As autumn passed, Pike and his men struggled north along the Mississippi, and the going got tougher and tougher. They should really have taken a lesson from the timber rattlesnakes they passed. Start looking for a winter shelter. But instead, Pike led his men further north. These rocky bluffs overlooking the river are where the rattlesnakes will escape the worst of winter. As autumn progresses, snakes from all over the forest make their way here. Deep crevices and cracks will provide secure retreats for the snake as it hibernates through the winter to come. This far north, the climate is so cold that timber rattlesnakes have to spend 7 months of the year in hibernation. Lewis and Clark also witnessed a spectacular autumn. 1,500 miles to the west, on the upper reaches of the Missouri. The bright autumn colors of cottonwoods told Lewis and Clark that winter was just around the corner. The prairies put on one last display of flowers. Great areas are turned yellow by sunflowers and goldenrod. But the Corps continued with their observations. They were amazed at how fast a pronghorn could run.
I think I can safely venture the assertion that the speed of this animal is equal, if not superior, to that of the finest blooded courser.
Throughout their journey, the Corps had also seen great herds of elk. But now in autumn, they could also hear them. It's the rutting season, when males try to gather up groups of females and defend them against rival males. A shrill whistling, called bugling, advertises the male's dominance, and if challenged, he'll use his great rack of antlers. The ability to defend a herd of females is so important that young males spend much of the autumn practicing their technique, ready for the time they'll need to fight in earnest. After spending their first winter with Mandan Indians, the expedition pressed on. But eventually they were stopped by a series of waterfalls. The Great Falls of the Missouri. Ahead, they could see a great wall of rock and stone rising from the plains, the Rocky Mountains. Now they would have to leave the river and seek a route across the mountains to the Pacific. And another winter would pass on the Great Plains before the expedition finally returned to the Missouri. Lewis and Clark's second winter was warm, wet, and rainy, spent on the Pacific coast of Oregon. But back along the Missouri, great flocks of birds were flying south to escape the bitter cold of a high plains winter. Other creatures have no choice but to face it out. Warm, shaggy coats protect bison through the worst of the weather. And even before the last snows have melted, the sounds of spring begin to fill the air. Sharp-tailed grouse are gathering on their communal display grounds. And overhead, great flocks of birds begin to make their way north again. Sandhill cranes are on their way from wintering grounds in the south to Canadian nesting grounds. But first, they head for the Platte River, a tributary of the Missouri. This is a staging post, a chance for them to feed and recover, ready for the last leg of their journey ahead. On their way back, Lewis and Clark were able to explore several of the Missouri's major tributaries, like the Yellowstone, that plunges over spectacular falls in the Yellowstone Gorge. They'd reached their goal, the Pacific, by way of the Columbia River, but it was no easy route. And it was with great relief that they reached the Missouri again. Moving swiftly downstream in spring, Lewis noted the great northward migration, particularly of a kind of goose he called the white brant.
The white brant associate in very large flocks. They do not appear to be mated or paired off as if they intended to raise their young in this quarter. I therefore doubt whether they reside here during the summer for that purpose.
Lewis was quite right. We now know these birds as snow geese, and they're on their way to nesting grounds in Arctic Canada. Today, these flocks might be even more spectacular than those seen by Captain Lewis. And that's because the sea of grass that Lewis and Clark saw has been replaced by a sea of crops. The Great Plains are now covered by industrialized farming on a truly enormous scale. Snow geese descend like blizzards onto these vast fields, and the extra food seems to have allowed them to increase their numbers dramatically. The Missouri and Mississippi rivers have changed as much as the plains since Lewis and Clark saw them. Both rivers are now dammed and contained and have been turned into superhighways. Jefferson would have been impressed. North of its junction with Missouri, the Mississippi was a difficult river to navigate in anything larger than a birch bark canoe. There were sandbars, rapids, and even waterfalls. Now, a series of dams have turned the river as far north as Minneapolis into a series of deep pools, easily navigable by even the largest barges. Each dam has an associated lock, and this is the biggest on the river. Big enough to take a barge pushing 12 enormous containers in one go. In just a few minutes, the whole lot is raised to the level of the higher pool and continues on its way. But traveling upstream was nothing like this easy for Pike and his men. By now, they were beginning to feel the grip of winter. In its upper reaches, the Mississippi is hard to follow through the vast northern forests, and his men were beginning to struggle. The rivers here run in and out of lakes, which have many other streams flowing into them. So it was hard for Pike to know which to follow, and he never bothered to seek local knowledge from the Indians, as previous explorers had. Eventually, after leaving most of his party behind, Pike reached a lake that he thought was the ultimate source of the Mississippi. He'd reached Leech Lake, and today we know he was still many miles short of his target. Pike would have had to navigate through several more lakes to follow the contorted journey of the river to its ultimate source, at Lake Itasca. Today, thousands of people each year make the trip to see the humble beginnings of the great river as it tumbles over a small weir from Lake Itasca. Part of Pike's problem was the sheer number of interlinked lakes in Minnesota. Not for nothing, it is called the Land of 10,000 Lakes. But those same lakes give the upper Mississippi its richness, a magnet for flocks of waterfowl, such as trumpeter swans. It would be nearly another 30 years before anyone else tried to find the source of Old Man River. This time, Henry Schoolcraft had the sense to ask the local Ojibwe Indians. the Ojibwe knew this portion of the river well, a river they called Mississippi, the Great Water, and one of them, called Otsawindip, agreed to take schoolcraft to the source. Schoolcraft also took his assistant along on the trip. Otsawindip led the small party through the forest and along a river which twisted and turned as if it was deliberately trying to throw the explorers off the trail. But Otsawindip knew exactly where he was going, to a lake whose Indian name simply meant Elk Lake. Here, a small trickle of water overflowed the lake through a marsh, the first few feet of the Mississippi's 2,500-mile journey. One reason the source had been so hard to find was that the river started by flowing north before making a huge sweep to turn south and finally head towards New Orleans. Schoolcraft's assistant suggested a new name for this lake, the True Head of the Mississippi. In Latin, True Head is Veritas Caput, and from this, Schoolcraft invented Itasca. Now finally, the sources of both the Mississippi and the Missouri were known. The Mississippi covers 2,400 miles from its source to the sea, and the Missouri is even longer, at 2,500 miles. Both rivers run through American history and culture like no others. The Mississippi and Missouri's characters change throughout their length, as well as throughout their history. From the wild river of the first French explorers, or Lewis and Clark's Core of Discovery, to the great steamboat days, and on to the industrial-scale waterway of today. Yet it's still possible to glimpse the past. Most of the creatures that Marquette or Lewis and Clark saw still live along the river, though no longer in the abundance witnessed by the first explorers. But these great rivers of North America are still rich in both wildlife and culture. And their journey will go on into an unknown future. Perhaps Old Man River is not as abundant as it was when the first explorers saw it. It's a very different place now. But it's still a lifeline for the culture, history, and wildlife of North America.
Man, I'm a hard working man. From morning to late, can't get it out of my head until I get old. I'm gonna pick that white gold. Old Man River going past. Old Man River going fast. Old Man River free. Lord, I'm free at last. And I'm gonna stay till Old Man River free.